So this big title actually to deliver in 10 minutes. So apologies for that. First of all, I just want to give you a little bit of background about me. I'm head of cultural heritage and archaeology for WSP. We're a design consultant. We're one of the biggest design consultants in the UK and a global consultant too. My perspective is from a multidisciplinary angle. So I work very closely with other environmental agencies. And a lot of what I'm presenting today is going to be relating from that experience. Now, what I want to be clear about is that this is really trying to provoke a response, but these are two really serious disruptors, if you like, that we need to deal with as we go forwards. If you don't want to listen to me, these are sort of the main points. So going forwards, I think it's really important to see that what I'm really looking at is from a contracting archaeological side and from a planning perspective. Now, and looking at how changes are possibly necessary within our sector to deal with these two disruptors that we can see. First of all, hang on a second. Looking at cities and local authorities, we can tell that budgets and finances are now controlled by central government. They're incentivized in order to deal with responses to carbon reduction. This is now a fact, and it's something that everybody has to deal with. Now, the UK government has just released its biodiversity net gain consultation response, and as part of that, there's a real refocus on investment approaches that deal with climate change. Now, these are really sort of strong issues for us as a sector, and we need to sort of understand what archaeologists are doing. We talk about climate change, but we don't talk about the impact that archaeological work has on the climate. So one of the areas that we really want to have a look at is to see what we might need to do to make change in our approaches and processes. You're probably aware that the way that we approach archaeology has been the same for nearly 30 years. We have design documentation we follow, and we do a four-stage process, if you like, with documentary review, followed by evaluation, non-intrusive, then intrusive, and then mitigation. The intrusive work has a substantive effect on the environment, and it's an area that we need to really home in on and concentrate. Now, are we doing enough? I mean, that is a question. Are archaeologists doing enough to control that? I question whether we are. We've been working with National Highways quite recently, and they've been really keen on their supply chains demonstrating a response to carbon impact, which means that all archaeological contractors now need to review that and review how they're managing that process. Now, I think they're doing a fairly good job at the moment, but it has to improve. We've had a conversation with an expert at National Highways in carbon reduction, and their comment was really quite simple. I think a lot of the archaeologists in the room were saying, well, you know, what we're doing has much less impact than the road you're building. And it's very, very true. But net zero means zero. And it means that everybody has to demonstrate that they're responding to that. And that means that the processes that we use and the procedures that we follow need to be scrutinized in terms of net zero and carbon reduction. Now, how do we do that? Now, it's a really interesting sort of perspective. If I'm a change manager, I'm going to be looking at process, I'm going to be looking at product, I'm going to be looking at new technologies, and I'm going to be looking at new outcomes, potentially new markets and new audiences. And I think this is the point that we need to now address, that whatever we're doing, we need to think along those lines. So, for example, if we're looking at what we're doing, could we be doing it smarter? Now, if you want to reduce carbon impact, you need to design smarter. We need a smart archaeology for the future. That might mean that we need to front load some of the works that we do, non-intrusive works. It also might mean that we need to change what we do and introduce new technology. So it might mean that we need to look at some of the innovation that's happening around at our universities and translate that into commercially ready to take forward. Do we need new audiences? Well, yes, we always do need audiences. And I think Peter this morning made that really clear, that we are only as good as the audience that are following us, which means that we need new outputs. And that might be reusing data. It might be looking at AI. It might be looking at a whole range of other sort of areas that are really important for us. But those, as a change manager, those are the areas I think that we need to sort of really focus on and think about. Now, the other disruptor is digital transformation. Now, that is something that I think we really need to get our heads around. I'll put that down here, sorry. It's all a bit clunky without paper. We've been talking in sector quite a lot, I think, about how we want to reform, you know, our systems in the UK, better resources for the regulatory side of the profession. But of course, that's not really possible. You know, we're just such a small component of the planning process. And quite frankly, that isn't going to happen. We've got now DCOs and EIAs that are taking years to deliver, that are being contested, which take even longer. A lot of the archaeological contractors in the room will recognise that they're waiting for projects to arrive, which are going to take years to actually deliver because of those processes. Digital EIA has just been sort of announced, so it's just come out. And with digital EIA, there's the opportunity of using all the data that's being captured. And that data can be used using AI. It's already apparent that AI is being used, or is being researched at least, to reduce caseload in the planning system. And I think that we need to recognise that. It's also being used to be as a predictive tool in EIAs. Now, in the next 5 to 10 years, we cannot ignore that that is going to change the way we see things. That hasn't come out very well, unfortunately. This is an image from Internet Archaeology. It sort of essentially maps out all of the research titles in academic archaeology over a period of time, and it tells you what's actually been studied. Now, I'm just going to sort of be provocative and say, well, what if we took the UK planning system, we were able to sort of take every single document that's been produced, DCO, EIA, grey literature reports, survey, academic reports, HER, put all that data in one database, use AI research to actually look at every single paragraph in every single document to actually identify patterns in that data. Now, sounds wild, doesn't it? But it's actually happening in other disciplines. They're already doing it. Now, this is all already being done. The capability is absolutely there. And I know that because I've been working with two AI companies over the last year. So all of this is possible to do. And if we did that, we would be able to create our own research designs. You know, the AI would actually produce research designs for us to follow in the planning system. And as we added data to that, those research designs could actually develop still further. So it's a very exciting prospect, I think, for the future. And it's something that we really need to be conscious of. But of course, when we're talking about the good side of all of this, there's a bad side too. And that is, if we don't, as professionals and experts in our field, get involved with the AI debate relating to the planning system, then there's a possibility that we'll lose out big time. So what we really need is co-creation. And that means that not one organization or one part of our sector can deliver this on their own. We need innovation coming from universities. We need startup companies coming out of universities who are delivering the commercial sector. That has happened before, 30 years ago, from Bradford University, geophysics arrived. So it is possible in the future, but we really do need to capture that and make sure that we're working together with universities, we're working together with all of the institutions, and that we're working together with the curators, the regulator, who have such an influence on the decisions that are being made currently. Now, this is a massive challenge, and I'm not going to give you an answer to it, but I do think going through that stepped process of change is really important if we're going to deliver on these two really key disruptors going forwards. We need a smart approach, and it needs co-creation. Thank you.